Hello mathematicians, today we see a nice problem. This is a sort of complex analysis and a real analysis mixed problem. Let's see. Let A be set of all z belongs to complex numbers such that modulus of z strictly greater than 1. Set of all z belongs to C such that z not equal to 0. Non-zero complex number is denoted by the set B. Then which of the following statements are true? There is a continuous onto function f from a to b. There is a continuous one-one function from b to a. There is a non-constant analytic function f from b to a. There is a non-constant analytic function f from a to b. Okay. Now, one advantage of this problem is these two set can be visualized. Okay. In complex plane, you can easily visualize these sets. So, we can solve this problem completely geometrically, like just by some diagrams you can solve this problem easily. So in all our arguments there is always a picture. That picture will explain what happens very easily. Okay, so in that sense it is a very interesting problem. This is asked in 2016 CSIR exam June part C problem. Okay, so let's see the solution. Before see the solution, if you are new to my YouTube channel, please subscribe to my channel. If you are like my videos, please click the like button. Okay. Okay. Let's start the solution. So as usual, we eliminate the wrong option and we theoretically prove the right option. We start with the simplest most solution first. Okay. Now note that A consists of set of all complex number whose modulus is at least 1. B consists of set of all complex number which is non-zero. Okay, clearly if you take a point here, then its modulus is strictly greater than 1. Okay, now the element 0 in the complex plane has modulus 0, therefore 0 does not belongs to A. Okay, and so you can see that this A is a subset of B, because every element of A is non-zero. All the non-zero elements are belongs to B. Okay, therefore we observe that A is subset of B. Now whenever you have a one set subset of another set, what you can do, you can define a function f from A to B by f of x equal to x. What is this? This is just the identity function. Okay, then this function makes sense. This is well defined because A is subset of B. So if you take a x here, that x will belongs to here also. That makes this function well defined. And we know that identity functions are analytic functions because they are polynomials. All the polynomial functions are analytic and this is a non-constant function. So we get there is a non-constant analytic function f from A to B. We can simply take the identity function from A to B. Okay, therefore fourth option is true. Okay, next we deal with options 1 and 2, and then we come back to third option. Third option requires a little bit more work. Okay, okay. So to solve problems A and options A and options 1 and 2, we draw some diagrams and we try to understand. Okay, now to solve problems 1 and 2, we need polar coordinates. Okay, so if you take a point in the complex plane, for example, consider this point. Okay, then this point, if in the usually we write it as x plus iy. Okay, where this x means that this distance. So if you project it on the x-axis or the real axis, this distance is x. Similarly, you project it onto y axis, this distance is y for this point, then x plus iy is this complex plane. Then this point is represented by x plus iy. In R2, we represent the same point by xy in R2. Okay, so this is usually this is how we write the points in the complex plane, but in polar coordinates, you have to first you draw origin and that point. Okay, then you see the length of this segment. Okay, and you call that number r, Then you see how much that how much angle that line segment making with the positive side of x axis, that is called argument. And then this r e power eta. So every point in the complex plane can be uniquely written as r e power eta, r e power I theta, where r is the distance between that point to the zero. So for example, this is my point z, then z can be written as r e power I theta, where theta is the, this theta is called argument, this r is called modulus, where this r can, r is nothing but distance between zero to that point z, and theta is the that line segment, the how much angle it made with the positive direction of x axis or the real axis, that is what we call theta. Okay, so this way every point can be uniquely written as r e power I theta. This is called polar coordinates. Okay, now let's make some observation. Suppose this distance is r. Okay, then you draw, suppose this distance is r, then you draw a circle of radius r. Okay, then all the points in this circle will have modulus r. Okay, so you take any point here, all these points, if written in polar coordinates, this r won't change. Only the theta will change, and note that this is circle is 360 degree, therefore 0 less than or equal to theta less than or equal strictly less than 2 pi. Okay, so pi is 180 degree, so 2 pi is 360 degree. Okay, therefore if it is a circle of radius, so let's denote the circle of radius r center at 0 by c subscript r, that consists of set of all points in the complex plane whose moduluses are those are points lying in this circle whose radiuses are, and they can be uniquely written as r e power I theta, where 0 less than or equal to theta strictly less than 2 pi. Okay, so now we have understood all the circles center at origin. Now let's come back to our set A. Okay, so what is our set A? So A consists of set of all complex number whose modulus is strictly greater than 1. Okay, so for example, let's look at this diagram. Suppose this is my circle of radius 1. Okay, so every point on this circle will have modulus equal to 1. If I take a point here, its distance from origin will be strictly less than 1. Okay, therefore all this point will be lying in a circle of radius whose radius is strictly less than 1. If I take a point here, then this point will lie on a circle center at origin whose radius is strictly greater than 1. Okay, now the set A, set of all A belongs to C, such that mod z greater than 1 are precisely the points lying outside the circle of radius 1. Okay, so this is a circle of radius 1. You take all the points lying outside this circle, that is our set A. Similarly, the set B is given by, in the complex plane, you just remove 0, in particular C star. So C star is our set B. You just remove 0, then whatever points you are getting, though, that is our set B. Okay, now if you take any point here in A, they will lie in some circle whose radius is strictly greater than 1. If you take a point here in the set B, then all those, if, for example, if I take this point, okay, then it will be lie in a circle whose radius lies between 2 and 3. But I can take a point here also. It will lie on a circle whose radius is less than 1. Okay, note that this is 1, this is 2, this is 3. Okay, so here the points are can be described as points lying on a circle whose radius is positive. It can be any number. Okay, we are just excluding 0. Here the points of A are points lying on a circle whose radius is strictly greater than 1. Okay, so that's how we want to visualize our sets A and B. So the points of A are points lying in a circle center at origin whose radius is strictly greater than 1. Similarly, points in B are points lying on a circle whose radius is positive, just positive, because we are just removing 0. So the even the circle of radius half is also allowed here. Okay, so that is our first observation. Now using this, now if you just look at the radiuses, okay, of the circles, then this is the set of all radius, set of all radius you get corresponds to the set A. This is the set of all radius you get corresponds to the set B. Why? So you take any element here and you draw the circle of that radius center at origin, and then all the points lying on that circle will belongs to A. Similarly, you take a point in the interval open 0 comma infinity and you draw a circle of that radius, then every point lying on that circle will belongs to B. Okay, now in the option A, they are saying that there is a continuous onto function f from A to B, or there is a continuous one function f from B to A. Okay, so here we are looking at circles whose radius is strictly greater than 1. Here we are looking at all the circles of some positive radius. So what we need is, so to get a continuous function from here to here, what do you do? So here you have bigger circles, right? A radius at least 1. Then somehow you have to shrink it. Shrink means you have to reduce the radius. Then you can go here. Similarly, if you want to go from here to here, here even small circles are here, but you have only larger circles, circles of radius at least 1. So from here to here, somehow you have to expand the circles, okay, or enlarge the circle. Then you can go from here to here. So that is our geometric idea. Let's see what to do. So these are the radiuses. So how I can go from here to here? If you define pi of r equal to r minus 1. Okay, so I am subtracting 1 from all the points. Okay, then open 1 comma infinity is mapped to open 0 comma infinity. Similarly, its inverse function, from 0 comma infinity to 1 comma infinity. So phi inverse of r is r plus 1. Okay, then open 0 comma infinity is mapped to open 1 comma infinity. Why do we need this? Because to go from here to here, I take a circle of radius r, then I map to circle of radius r minus 1. Okay, then that way I can map all the circles of radius at least 1 to circle whose radius is positive. For example, if you look at a circle of radius 1.2, it will goes to circle of radius 0.2. Okay, also we are going to just change the radius, we are not going to change the argument. That means that suppose this is, you note that this is a circle of radius 2, because this point is 2, then this will go here to circle of radius 1, such a way that suppose you have a point here whose radius, whose argument is theta, image of this point will be again the same point, only modulus is reduced to 1, but this point also has the same argument theta. Okay, so we are fixing the modulus. For example, if you take this point, we are fixing the argument only, modulus going to change. If you look at this point has modulus, if you take this point, it will have modulus 2. Argument is, so how much angle it makes with positive direction of real axis, 90 degree. Okay, so this point has argument 90 degree. If you look at the image of this function from A to B, so it will goes to the circle of radius 1, but the argument will be same. Okay, so this point is mapped to this point,
but only modulus is changed to 1, but argument we are just keeping it. Okay, so if you can visualize it correctly, if you can visualize it, so circle of radius 2 is mapped to circle of radius 1. We are just shrinking it. Okay, similarly, if you look at for example, say this orange color circle, if this is a circle of radius 1 by 2, it is shrink to circle of radius 0.2. In general, a circle of radius r is shrink to circle of radius r minus 1. Okay, from here to here, you take a circle of radius r, you change, you send it to circle of radius r plus 1, but don't change the argument, only change the modulus. For example, if you look at this point, this point will go to this point. Okay, now the modulus is 2, but the argument is same. Okay, that is our idea. So let's see how to do that. So from A to B, I am defining a function f of r e power I theta equal to r minus 1 times e power I theta. What it does is a circle of radius r is going to circle of radius r minus 1 without affecting the argument. Similarly, the inverse of this function. Okay, so inverse of this function is given by b to a. F inverse of r e power I theta is r plus 1 times e power I theta. Okay, then what it does is circle of radius r is mapped to circle of radius r plus 1. Okay, so here we are reducing the radius by 1, here increasing the radius by 1. Okay, so that's how we can move from here to here, we can move from here to here, and we claim that these two functions, a to b, this function, b to a, this function, these two functions are continuous functions. Okay, so how to do prove these two functions are continuous? So first I prove that this f is continuous, then similarly you can I leave it to you guys to exercise to prove f inverse is continuous. So to prove continuity, we'll use the sequence criterion. So suppose zn tend to z, then f of zn tend to f of z. This is the sequence criterion we want to prove, we want to use. Suppose zn tend to z, okay, and note that f is a function from a to b. Okay, so now this each of them are complex number. So the zn, the modulus of zn, I take rn, then the argument of zn I take to be e power I theta n. Argument of zn I take to be theta n. Therefore, zn equal to r subscript n e power I theta subscript n. And z I take to be r e power I theta. Okay, so this is our assumption, zn tends to z. We claim that f of zn tend to f of z. In other words, what is f of zn? Rn minus 1 times e power I theta n. Note that we are not changing the argument, we are checking only the modulus. So f of zn, f of z is r minus 1 times e power I theta. We claim that this sequence converges to this sequence. Okay, so we have, suppose we have zn tend to z. Suppose if rn converges to r and if theta n converges to theta, then rn minus 1 will converges to r minus 1, theta n converges to theta anyway, so we'll get the desired result. Okay, let me explain. This is a very common exercise in complex analysis. So whenever a complex sequence zn converges to another complex number, then our respective moduluses also respect the convergence. In other words, if zn is given by this function rn, zn is given in polar coordinate like this and z is given in polar coordinates like this, then if zn converges to z, then this rn converges to r and theta n converges to theta. Okay, this is a very important result. So I leave it to you guys to as an exercise. Okay, you try to prove it. Or you can check complex analysis S. Ponnuswamy's book. Okay, so we have rn, since zn converges to z, we have rn converges to r. If rn converges to r, then rn minus 1 converges to r minus 1. Okay, therefore we want to prove f of zn converges to f of z. Now I have proved rn minus 1 converges to r minus 1, and I have to prove theta n converges to theta. But since Zn converges to Z, theta n converges to theta by this result. Therefore, we conclude that f of Zn converges to f of Z. Therefore, f is continuous. Using the same reasoning, you can prove that Rn minus 1 goes to R plus 1. Okay, that will prove that f inverse is also continuous. Now, like geometrically, you can see that you need an onto function f from a to b, and what we do, like geometrically you can see that these functions are onto and 1 1 also. Okay, I leave it to, actually these functions are bijection, that is why we are okay. So that is a very simple method. Why? Because if you look at f composition f inverse, you will get identity. Similarly, f inverse composition f also identity. That means that f has inverse. Therefore, f has to be a bijection. Okay. So even we have constructed a bijection, continuous bijection between a to b. Okay. Therefore, these two options are true. So let's do option 3.
In third option, there is a non-constant nullity function f from b to a, that is the option, but we claim that there is no non-constant nullity function f from b to a. Therefore, this option is false. Okay, so how do we prove that? We take a arbitrary analytic function from b to a, and we prove that is a constant function. Therefore, there is no non-constant nullity function from b to a. That is our idea. Okay, so let's see how to prove this. Okay, so we claim that there is a non-constant nullity function f from b to a, that is what given, but this is false. Okay, that is what we are claiming. So let f from b to a let f from b to a be an analytic function. We take an arbitrary analytic function, and we will prove that function has to be a constant function. Okay. So what we do, we define a function g from c to c. Okay, complex number to complex plane by g of z equal to f composition e power z inverse. Okay. And so that f composition e power z means f of e power z inverse. So this means that 1 by f composition is it. Okay, maybe this is better notation, otherwise it may be a little bit confusing. 1 by f composition e power z. So we want to consider this function to conclude that f is a constant function. So let's see how to use it. Okay, it is given that f is an analytic function. Okay, we have taken a analytic function from b to a, therefore f is analytic, and e power z is an analytic function, we know. Therefore, their composition is an analytic function. Okay. Now, e power z is an analytic function, actually entire function from c to c star, non-zero complex number. E power z never take, it won't take zero value. Therefore, it is goes from c to c star surjective entire function. Now, and yeah, it is a bijection. Onto only, so let's just assume it is surjective. Okay, so e power z goes from c to c star, and so c star contains the set b. Okay, yes, so now f from b to a is analytic, that is what we have assumed. So let f from b to a be an analytic function, and b is non-zero complex numbers. So this c star is nothing but our set b. So actually this should be equality. Now f from b to a is analytic. Now f composition e power z is a function from c to a, because e power z goes from c to b, then f goes from b to a. Therefore, when you compose, you get a function from C to A. Okay, note that C to B to A. This is my e power z function. This is our function f. Okay. Okay. Now, this is an analytic function. This is an analytic function because composition to analytic function is analytic. Now, in the set A is set of all z such that 0 less than mod z. Sorry. In 0 is not an element of A. Okay. Therefore,
this function f composite, f composition e power z, it won't take the value 0. Therefore, 1 by e f composition e power z also an analytic function. Okay. So, if f takes, sorry, f composition e power z is goes to a, where a equal to set of all z such that mod z strictly greater than 1. This is set a. If f composition e power z takes c to z of all z such that mod z strictly greater than 1, 1 by f composition e power z takes c to set of all z such that 0 less than mod z less than 1, because we are taking the reciprocal. Okay, because 1 by z, set of z goes to 1 by z, this function takes this set to this set. Okay, therefore 1 by f composition e power z takes c to this set. Okay, now this is an entire function because it is analytic in C. Now this is also an entire function because it is analytic in C, but this is a bounded set. Therefore, by Liouville's theorem, it is a bounded an entire function. Therefore, this is a constant function, but e power z is not a constant function. Therefore, f has to be a constant function. Okay. So what we have proved, we take arbitrary analytic function from B to A, and we have proved that we take arbitrary analytic function from B to A, and we have proved that f has to be a constant function. Okay. Yeah, it is a very, very nice trick. It will be useful in other problems also. Okay. So if you learned something new from this video, please click the like button and share with your friends also, and subscribe to my channel. Thank you.